In this video, I'll be reassembling the Unimat SL and trying it out for the first time. Welcome to Adventures with a Very Small Lathe. I recorded this work in the last few weeks I spent away from home, staying with family and using a borrowed workshop space. It was late 2021 and the winter weather was really setting in, which made working a lot less comfortable, and the light in the workshop was very variable. The first section I'm going to reassemble will be the spindle. All parts inside the spindle need to be kept pretty clean, so I'm working on a freshly cleaned bench. In order, the parts are the spindle housing, the spindle shaft, the conical preload springs, the inner and outer parts of the rear bearing, and the spacer. I'll need to grease the bearings so the tissue will help to contain the grease from making too much mess. The outer race for the front bearing is still pressed into the housing, so I wipe that down to remove any dust that has accumulated. High precision spindles are extremely sensitive to any contamination. The Unimat spindle isn't anywhere near that level of precision, but it's still good practice to avoid contamination as much as possible. I'm using molybdenum disulfide grease, which is described as suitable for bearings. There's information online from other Unimat owners about selecting the right grease, but I chose this as one that was readily available before I tracked down that info. I don't think it'll matter all that much, as this is still decent grease. I'm trying to get the grease between the bearing balls, and straight away I'm making a huge mess with it. Since recording this video, I've learned that it's better to be much more controlled and careful about applying bearing grease, as there shouldn't be too much and it should be kept in the right place. Check out Bills Workbench video on overhauling the Unimat SL headstock for a much better guide to greasing these bearings. The link is at the top right now or in the description below. Once I felt like I had enough grease between the balls, I lightly coated the outer race. I also lightly coated the shaft with grease to protect the shaft sitting inside the spacer. This probably wasn't a good idea, as it's actually just extra mess. Now the spacer can be fitted onto the spindle shaft. The spacer needs to go the correct way around, as was noted during disassembly. There's a large chamfer on one end, which should be the end furthest from the front of the spindle. The shaft can now be placed back into the spindle housing, fitting the two halves of the bearing together, and they seem to fit together just fine. I need to install the rest of the spindle parts at the rear, but now the spindle shaft is in the way. Firstly, I need the spindle shaft out of the way to wipe the bearing seat at the back of the spindle clean. At this point, I should have just removed the shaft altogether, as it's going to be in the way until everything else is in place. The first of the parts of the rear is this pair of back-to-back conical leaf springs, which preload the bearings. When I removed them, they were coated in grease, so I'll give them a light coating now. It turns out to be very difficult to make sure they're seated properly with the shaft in place, so I take it out again. Once the shaft is out of the way, they can be nudged into position with the inner edges in contact. Now the rear outer race goes in and gets a thin coat of grease. Now is the right time for the spindle shaft to be put in place. Finally, the inner part of the rear bearing gets fully greased. This type of bearing is called a magneto bearing, and from what I've read, it's considered a type of deep groove bearing with the outer groove on the open on one side. This makes them extremely easy to disassemble without damaging them or needing a press, but also causes limitations. The groove can only withstand axial forces in one direction, so in order to be useful, these bearings are often installed in pairs and need to be preloaded to hold the ball train into the groove. The inner race slips into place easily, and now I just have to clean up the mess I probably shouldn't have made in the first place. The rear drive pulley forms the back of the spindle, closing the bearing to protect against dirt and also transmitting the preload force to compress the springs and keep everything in the spindle in place. The preload force is provided by this nut, which holds the whole spindle together. As far as I've read, the nut needs to be tightened until the springs are fairly compressed and the spindle feels like it's turning just fine. The next section is the tailstock, starting with the main casting. This bushing is the first part to install, which acts as a bearing for the tailstock feed screw and needs to be tapped into place. Remember not to use a steel hammer for jobs like this. Don't be like me. The bushing is locked into place with a pointed grub screw which fits into a detent on the bushing. This is tightened using a normal straight screwdriver and needs to be reasonably tight so that it doesn't shake loose. Some light oil on the bearing surface to make sure nothing rubs. The screw has a large threaded section to feed the quill and a smaller thread to attach the handle. In between is a smooth bearing section which sits in the bushing. The screw itself slips easily into place and the handle threads on, but for now there's nothing to hold the screw still while the handle is screwed into place. The quill fits into the opposite end of the bore and needs to be oriented so the square keyway on top of the quill is aligned with the second threaded hole on top of the casting. I should have used slideway oil on the quill, but regular light oil shouldn't do any harm. It's easy to get the screw thread started into the quill, but now there's no way to hold the screw still to wind all the parts into place. The grub screw for the quill is square ended or dog point, so it sits neatly into the keyway. This screw shouldn't be tightened, it's just there for alignment, not for fixing or locking. Now it's easier to wind all the parts into the correct place. This clamping screw on the side is the tailstock quill lock. The camera stopped running mysteriously before I fitted the locking nut to the rear handle, but it works exactly the same way as the other two handles which need to be fitted, so we'll see how it was done later. The main lathe assembly starts with the cross slide body, and the first part to fit is the cross slide screw into the threaded hole in the middle. I struggled to find the correct order of parts during disassembly, but this time I started with a good idea of how things go together, and this seemed like the best place to start. This screw needs to be in the cross slide first, then slotted into place in the saddle before fitting the cross slide rails. Just like the tailstock screw, this screw will be held in place by its handle. I use a few drops of slideway oil on the rails and their corresponding holes in the saddle and the cross slide to get everything ready for the rails to go back into place. The first rail has a vertical hole at the end which should align with the hole in the saddle casting, which is a useful indicator of which rail is which. The second rail has no obvious signs, but is slightly mushroomed at one end, so it's not a good idea to force that end through first. The rails now need to be tapped into their final position. Remember, don't use a steel hammer for this. While away from my workshop, I was forced to improvise without my tools, but I should have found something better and safer than this. The rails are tapped into place, trying to avoid overshooting if possible. Now the rails are in place, the slide seems to move just fine and is certainly better than it was before cleaning, so the rails can be fixed into place by retaining screws fitted from the underside. The handle can now be screwed into place. I set the position of the handle by turning until it stops, then backing off a fraction. It needs to be right up against the casting, but not tight or it won't be able to turn at all. The closer it is to the casting, the less the backlash will be, but if it's too close, then the lathe will be hard to use, and there'll be wear between the handle and the casting. The handle is held with this closed end locking nut, which needs to be tightened carefully without shifting the handle from its correct position on the screw. The cross slide moves smoothly and the level of backlash feels acceptable. This wheel is the only one missing its handle, which will make it harder to use. Making a replacement handle will be a project I should get done soon. The completed carriage now needs to be fitted to the bed rails before the bed rails are fitted to the bed, so that's the next step. The ends of the rails with the holes furthest from the end sit under the headstock, so should go on the left from the perspective of the lathe operator. More slideway oil on the bed rails to make sure the carriage runs smoothly. The rails fit easily into the saddle, as they should. The main lead screw also needs to be in place before the bed rails are screwed to the bed. The handle needs to be at the tailstock end of the lathe, so the screw is fitted from the right hand side of the saddle and fits into a threaded hole through the saddle centre. Despite oiling the screw, it doesn't seem to be going in easily enough at all. It's too far out to be fitted to the bed yet, and I need to solve what's going on before going ahead with the assembly, or I won't be able to get access to fix it. The screw has to come out again and see what's in the threaded hole in the saddle obstructing it. It looks as though this hole wasn't cleaned effectively enough, so I'll give it a good scrub with a set of pipe brushes. It would have been great to have some compressed air to clean this out, as removing dirt from a threaded hole is a real pain with a brush. WD-40 helps loosen the dirt up a bit, but also makes it sticky. I also need to wipe and re-oil the end of the screw that got stuck in the dirt. Once everything is clean, it seems to move a lot more smoothly and is quickly in the right place for fitting the rails to the bed. A little light oil in the handle end of the screw fits into the base once the rails are lined up with the beveled grooves. Then the rails can be slid through the saddle until the holes are aligned with the bolt holes in the bed. The screw handle is fitted exactly the same way as the cross slide handle, aiming for the best trade-off between free movement and reducing backlash. The carriage is now moving smoothly along the bed rails, and everything is ready to attach the rails to the bed casting. The rails will be held in place by four bolts through the rails and tightened into nuts in the underside of the casting. The nuts are held and prevented from turning by the geometry of the voids in the bed casting, but need to be held in place while the bolts are fitted and screwed into place. As long as the holes are aligned, the rails should be precisely located parallel by the bevels in the machine grooves in the casting. The rails are prevented from rolling or slipping by the countersunk screws which add to the constraints on the rails. The bed is now fully assembled and the saddle is moving as it should. The final touch is to fit the locking screws for the cross slide and the saddle. The ability to lock these two axes is vital for getting the best cutting performance out of the machine. The tailstock can now be fitted using a little slideway oil. The The easiest way around seems to be to place the main body of the tailstock onto the bed rails, then slide the plate underneath and fit the screw to hold it into place. The tailstock moves correctly along the rails and there's no issue with the movement of the quill. The next step is to fit the headstock casting, but first I'm giving the inside of the spindle bore a good coat of slideway oil as it'll be much harder to reach once it's fitted. The retaining pin at the bottom of the headstock is oiled with light oil as it's not a working sliding surface. The pin fits into the bed casting and the headstock orientation is set to its regular position using the alignment pin at the front. Now the spindle can slide into the bore, making sure there's plenty of slideway oil. The keyway needs to align with the screw hole on top in much the same way as the similar keyway on the tailstock quill. Once again, a dog point scrub screw will sit in the keyway and keep the spindle aligned. The handle used to advance and retract the spindle should always be kept in place to make sure dirt doesn't get into the rack and pinion. I've seen some Unimat operators use this hole to store the Tommy bars for their chuck, which I really don't think is a good idea. It pretty much guarantees that swarf will get into the rack and spread from there into the bore. The two screws either side of the handle are to tighten the bore and lock the spindle in place. This is best for most lathe operations as the cutting forces can easily be strong enough to move the spindle if they're loose. To properly hold the headstock in place, this large retaining screw is fitted. It's an unusual custom screw with a tapered end, which aligns with the tapers in the headstock pin. This tapered fit ensures the headstock is firmly held down, while also allowing it to be rotated smoothly when loosened slightly. The final part to fit is the tool post, which is held in by a screw and a T-slot nut in the T-slot on the cross slide. The lathe now needs to be refitted to its steel base. The steel plate is also the mount for the heavier duty AC motor the lathe came with when I bought it. Apart from providing more torque and power, this motor solves a major problem which the Unimat SL motor is well known for, duty cycle. Running the original Unimat motor continuously for some time causes it to overheat and cut out, and can cause permanent damage. Unimat SL operators have to constantly keep an eye on how long the motor has been running, turning it off frequently to cool. This industrial AC motor has no issue with being run indefinitely, providing it isn't being otherwise abused. The lathe pulley and the motor pulley need to be lined up, which I can do with the headstock lever, then lock the spindle in place once it's correct. This is the downside of the bigger, more reliable motor. Because it's not mounted on the spindle housing, I lose the ability to freely advance or rotate the headstock. The motor drives the lathe with this sewing machine belt, which has seen better days, but it seems to work. I'll get a replacement on order. Now the belt is in place, I can do a final tweak of the pulley alignment and firmly lock the spindle in place. That seems to run fine, but to try it out I need something to hold work in. The chuck that came out of the lathe is still gummed up and I still haven't worked out how to strip it down for cleaning. In the meantime I'll make do with a cheap spare chuck I managed to pick up on eBay. The chuck diameter is a bit smaller than the original, and the body is much deeper. We'll see how well a chuck this cheap performs. It's a decent snug fit for the spindle thread and sits securely against the spindle flange. Like most chucks of its size, it uses Tommy bars rather than a chuck key. They're quite a bit fiddlier, but they work, and they reduce the number of moving parts inside the chuck. It seems to hold stock okay to start with. For the next step, I need a lathe tool to cut stock with, so let's make one out of this 6mm square high-speed steel. Fortunately, there's a decent-sized bench grinder to hand, though it isn't well set up, and the wheels haven't been well looked after. I'll start by thoroughly truing and dressing the front of the coarse wheel with a diamond dresser. The dresser removes a layer of the wheel's material, getting rid of the worn-out surface and making sure the fresh surface can grind well. Grinding my own lathe tools isn't a skill I've really honed or practiced yet, so don't take what I'm doing here as a good example. High-speed steel is pretty tolerant of heat, but my fingers aren't, so I dunk the tool in water frequently to keep it cool. I started by grinding the front face with both relief angles set at the same time, but obsessed way too much about trying to get rid of the concave curve from the wheel face. Grinding with the outer curved face of a wheel inevitably leaves a concave curved surface on the front of the ground part. It isn't necessary or even a good idea to flatten out the curve, as it's actually useful to help hone the edges well later. I then ground the front relief way more than necessary, both the angle and the length of the side ground. I then switched to the finer wheel, which was pretty badly glazed and badly needed dressing. I used this wheel to try and smooth the faces a bit, but I'm not sure I did much of any use. The wheels are badly balanced, and you can see how much the grinder vibrates as it spins down from the surface of the water cup I used to keep the tool cool. It looks like a herd of dinosaurs is passing by. The next step is to hone the cutting edges on a bench stone. Oil stops the stone getting clogged. My technique here is really sloppy. The main thing I'm trying to avoid is rolling the tool as I hone it, which would round the edges, making them dull. The tool has fundamentally two cutting edges defined by three surfaces, so all three have to be honed to make the edge as clean as possible. The cleaner the cutting edge, the less it will wear and the longer it will last. The corner of the two cutting edges also needs to have a radius, or it will be very weak and will wear very quickly, so I try to make sure the edge of the radius is honed correctly too. I'm pretty sure the tool could be improved a lot, but I'm going to put it into the tool post and give it a try. The shelf the tool rests on needs to be clean and free of debris, and both holding screws need to be tightened firmly. I know at this point it's not at the right height, but I have a trick for sorting that easily. I set the tool up so it has enough relief for facing. Now I take a few facing passes on the brass stock in the chuck. Because the tool is too low, a nub is left in the middle of the stock. This little protrusion is exactly at the tool height below center, so its radius is the height I need to raise the tool. I can find that distance by measuring the diameter of the nub and dividing by 2. The reading is 0.9mm, so I want to raise the tool about 0.4mm. It's better to be slightly under than slightly over to prevent rubbing. This pack of ready-made shims is sold specifically for use on small lathes. These shims are just under 0.2mm, so if I use 2 of them, then I should be in about the right place. Once again, make sure the surface the tool rests on is clean, or the shims won't set the right height correctly. I want to cut this tool to a more suitable length for this lathe, but I need a grinder with a cutting disc to do that, and I don't have one here. With the height adjusted, the tool seems to face the end really well, with no sign of a nub left, and no signs of being too high. Now to try some turning. Next time I grind a general purpose tool, I'll make sure it has relief for facing and turning without having to adjust it between operations. The tool is working just fine, but the workpiece just shifted in the chuck. The chuck had been quite tight, so that may have been a bit of debris shifting between a jaw and the stock. With the jaws retightened, it seems to grip better. For the final early test, I'm going to try this small piece of mystery steel I found on the shop floor. The surface finish isn't great, but given this shoddy cutting tool, I'm more than happy with how the lathe has performed. The lathe is ready for use, but my time at this temporary home is nearly at an end. I had hoped to be able to move into my new house soon, but that wasn't to be, and it was soon time to move into another temporary home with a slightly improvised workshop. The next video will be working out how to clean up the Unimat's original chuck. Thanks for watching, take care, I love you all.